We'll do verses 1 and 3, and then follow about with the opening prayer. Page 826. Everybody have it, let us say amen. And now that we have it, let's begin. When the Savior calls, I will answer. When he calls for me, I will hear. When the Savior calls, I will answer. I'll be somewhere listening for my name. Oh, I'll be somewhere listening. I'll be somewhere listening. I'll be somewhere listening for my name. Oh, I'll be somewhere listening. I'll be somewhere listening. I'll be somewhere listening for my name. And if my robe is white when he calls me, if my robe is white, I will hear. If my robe is white when he calls me, I'll be somewhere listening for my name. Oh, I'll be somewhere listening. I'll be somewhere listening. I'll be somewhere listening for my name. Oh, I'll be somewhere listening. I'll be somewhere listening. I'll be somewhere listening for my name. Oh, I'll be somewhere listening. I'll be somewhere listening. I'll be somewhere listening for my name. Oh, I'll be somewhere listening. I'll be somewhere listening. I'll be somewhere listening for my name.
Vamos a orar, hermanos. Dios les bendiga. Oremos. Bendito Dios, gracias te damos en estos momentos, Padre Santo. Te agradecemos, mi Dios, por la vida, por la salud que nos das, por darnos la oportunidad de ver este día, Padre Santo, y de estar aquí alabándote y glorificando tu santo nombre. Te agradecemos, Padre Santo, porque tú eres benigno, tú eres grande para con nosotros. Y también, Padre Santo, nos ayudas en toda prueba, en toda enfermedad. Nos bendices, Padre Santo, también en el caminar a diario, Padre Santo. Por ello te agradecemos, mi Dios, porque nos llenas de sabiduría. Nos das entendimiento también para comprender tu palabra, Padre Santo. Porque a veces nuestro ser carnal no quiere comprender o entender, Padre Santo, el mensaje de tu palabra para enderezar nuestras sendas. Por ello, mi Dios, te agradecemos porque día con día tú nos guías, tú nos cuidas, tú nos proteges. Señor Santo, también en esta oración, en esta petición, Padre Santo, de agradecimiento, no solamente, sino también, Padre Santo, te pido que bendigas a mis hermanos que están enfermos, que están postrados en una cama, Padre Santo, y no pueden venir a este lugar a adorarte. Te pedimos, Padre Santo, que tú proveas para ellos, para que ellos también puedan, a través de las plataformas que hay, Padre Santo, adorarte, escuchar el sermón y estar unidos con nosotros, aunque sea por las plataformas de Dios, y adorarte este primer día de la semana. Así pues, también, Padre Santo, te agradecemos y te pedimos por nuestros hermanos que trabajan en la milicia, mi Dios, que tú los bendigas donde quiera que estén. Bendice también a aquellos que tienen un trabajo muy difícil, Padre Santo, que es el salvaguardar la paz en todo el mundo. Bendice a todos ellos, Padre Santo, y también bendice a aquellos países que, en donde hay conflictos, mi Dios. Hay hermandad ahí también, Hay cristianos ahí en esos lugares, Padre Santo, y están sufriendo la opresión por causa de la política. Pedimos, Padre Santo, que tú nos bendigas a la iglesia de tu Hijo Jesucristo en todo el mundo, que nos ayudes, Padre Santo, a concentrarnos solamente en lo espiritual, porque para eso nos has llamado, mi Dios, a predicar el Evangelio solamente y a no meternos, Padre Santo, en lo político, mi Dios, porque eso nos divide, eso nos destruye. Por eso, mi Dios, pedimos que tú nos bendigas a que solamente seamos una sola mente, un solo cuerpo, como dice tu palabra, y a no desobedecerla, porque solamente vamos por el mundo llevando una bandera, y esa bandera es de la paz, esa bandera, Padre Santo, es del Evangelio, de Cristo, y no de otro hombre o de alguna persona. Por ello, mi Dios, pedimos que nos bendigas para estar siempre unidos, gozosos, contentos, y siempre proyectar tu palabra por doquier. Así pues, mi Dios, pedimos por todos nuestros hermanos que están en otras ciudades, en otros lugares, sé con ellos. También, Padre Santo, sé con la familia de nuestro hermano que se reunía aquí años atrás, que él ya partió, Padre Santo, para contigo, mi Dios, en estos días pasados. Sé con su familia, consuélale sus corazones. Así también, Padre Santo, pedimos que en esos momentos, mi Dios, esos cantos de adoración que te estamos elevando, tú los recibas en tu santo trono, mi Dios, y que nos esforcemos, Padre Santo, porque no le cantamos al hombre, sino estamos cantándote a ti, Padre Santo. Bendice a nuestro hermano que está llevando la guía de las cantos, y también bendice a nuestro hermano que va a predicar tu palabra, que sea palabra, Padre Santo, sabia, y que sea palabra que nos alimente, Padre Santo, para que así nos animemos y sigamos adelante. Señor, hay muchas cosas que te quiero pedir, pero tú conoces mi pensamiento, conoces el pensamiento y el corazón de mis hermanos, y también te pido que tú escuches esas peticiones que se quedan con ellos, que se quedan en mi corazón también. Pues te lo pido, te lo agradezco en el nombre de Cristo Jesús. Amén.
Good morning, Eastwood. Let us continue to pray. Heavenly Father, Almighty God, we humbly approach your throne to say thank you for raising us up to see another Lord's Day. Thank you for this time and space to praise and worship you and your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Thank you for extending to us your mercy and your grace when we don't live up to your full potential. We especially thank you for Jesus Christ for being completely obedient to the Father's will when you left your place in heaven, then taught us lessons that had been closed to us. May you continue to encourage us to read our Bibles so that we are ever mindful of these simple lessons. Please be with us now as we attempt to praise and worship you in a manner that will please our Father. At this time, we ask that you comfort those of our number who are not here due to illnesses. Please be with the orphans and widows, and may we be aware of their daily needs so that we can feel compassion towards them when they ask us for assistance. Be with the missionaries that travel throughout the world, spreading your good news to the young hearts in their region. Please protect those who are fleeing oppressive environments. Convict the dictators that are making these people flee into jungles and through dangerous rivers just to have a better life. Let the dictators of the world have a peek into the life of the Christian. Let them see the peace and tranquility we enjoy on a daily basis, and may this vision change their attitudes towards life. We ask now, Jesus Christ, that you still our minds long enough to praise and worship the Father and give him all the glory and honor he deserves. These things we pray in your name, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
Page 684. We'll do verse 1 and 3. If we all have it, let us say amen. And if we all have it, let's begin. This world is not my home. I'm just a passing through. My treasures are laid up somewhere beyond the blue. The angels beckon me from heaven open door. And I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Oh Lord, you know I have no friends like you. If heaven's not my home, then Lord, what do I do? The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Just up in glory land, we'll live eternally. The saints on every hand are shouting victory. Their songs are sweet of praise. They're back from heaven's shore, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. Oh Lord, you know I have no friends like you. If heaven's not my home, then Lord, what will I do? The angels beckon me from heaven's open door, and I can't feel at home in this world anymore. I apologize on there, guys. I was a little bit off on the note part. So I had to tweak that one a little bit more on my end. As we prepare our minds and hearts for the Lord's Supper, let's go to page 742. So for this one, let's see, instead of doing the all verses, I apologize, guys. We'll do verse 1, 2, and 5. I want to do verse 1, 2, and 5 for the Lord's Supper. I apologize back there. Verse 1, 2, and 5. And if we all have it, let us begin. When I survey the wondrous cross on which the Prince of Glory died, my riches gain I count but loss. And pour contempt on all my pride. Forbid it, Lord, that I should boast, saved in the death of Christ, my Lord. All the vain things that charm me most, I sacrifice them to His blood. Were the whole realm of nature that were a present far too small, love so amazing, so divine, demands my soul.
Welcome, everybody. In Hosea 1, 7-10. But I will have mercy upon the house of Judah, and will save them by the Lord their God, and will not save them by bow, nor by sword, nor by battle, by horses, nor by horsemen. Now when he had, 7-10. Yet the number of children of Israel shall be as the sand of the sea, which cannot be measured nor numbered. It shall come to pass in the place where it is said unto them, ye are not my people. There it shall be said unto them, ye are the sons of the living God. How great thou art, merciful God. Thy patience endureth to the end and beyond our shortfalls of sin. Thy kingdom stands alone in all goodness of purity. Thou art the one only to rule in thy place. Thy kingdom needeth not towers and armor to defend. It needeth not watch at the gate to sound the horn. Thy glory has stopped in its proper place and put away all evil by thy Son, Christ Jesus. Our Lord, by all right, in his forthcoming of being the firstborn of all life, to offer himself unto thee in all honor and virtue. Thy infinite wisdom and knowledge has brought what seemed impossible possible, a unity of human flesh to thy spiritual world and kingdom. Thy Son Christ, our Savior, in him does all life flow through. In him did the flesh begin. In him brought forth us, crafted in thy own image. He walked upon the earth softly in thy ways, speaking words of enlightenment. Can the best of any musician play anything charming that would satisfy the heart of our ears? Thy say striketh to the nature. Thou art silent before us. We listen, we hear. A thousand storms cannot quiet thee. Thy truth breaketh all before thee. Oh, how thy intensity of might standeth before all, how all are toppled before thee. Thou walkest the earth to show and place thy mercy. Thou walkest the earth to give thy life. Thou hast done all for us, fought our fight to thy kingdom of glory. Had we to do anything with that? 3 days thou hast brought the victory, dispersed our darkness, brightened by thy crown of light, clothed in thy robe fit for a king, garnished in righteousness to dispense thy judgment. Thy throne thou art seated, mercy thou hast given, heaven thou hast opened, spikenard filleth the air. How the preciousness of it fills our senses. We bow in awe to thee. Has any other master done so in all securement of all eternity? Thou alone hast done so in thyself. Lord, accept our praise to thee. Thou alone art King and Maker. With one breath it became so. Accept our thanksgiving. Thou hast clothed us in thy cleanliness by thy death to God the Father. How can a war be won by one sacrifice? The loveliness of it, it is so uncanny. Can we comprehend? Thy thought and design of salvation is of perfection. We bring remembrance of thee, Lord, this day, how thou hast numbered us to thy place, where we be called sons of the living God. We break and partake this bread, which thou hast given willingly, O Lord, with heart of thought to thee. Help us to be conveyed of thy sacredness that is in thee and in this moment. In thy most holy name we pray, Christ Jesus. Amen. In Hosea 2, 18 to 20 and 23. And in that day will I make a covenant for them with the beast of the field and with the fowls of heaven and with the creeping things of the ground. And I will break the bow and the sword and the battle out of the earth. And I will make them to lie down safely. And I will betroth thee unto me forever. Yea, I will betroth thee unto me in righteousness and in judgment and in loving kindness and mercies. I will even betroth thee unto me in faithfulness, and thou shalt know the Lord. And I shall sow her unto me in the earth, and I will have mercy upon her that had not obtained mercy. And I will say unto them which are not my people, thou art my people, and they shall say, thou art my God. Lord, our loving Father of all life, thou hast created by thy might and power. Thou art a God of all knowledge and discernment that pertaineth to everything living, both past and future. Thou standest above all that is about thee. Mighty in thy glory, the one and true God we believe in, with our trust to thee of our souls. Thy enlightenment of thy wonderful words bring up all hope to those in despair. A promise heard far away, brought near to our hearts, which bringeth us near to thee. Our Lord, our Christ, let us able to be grasped in thy reaping of the field, to be counted as one of thy own. Thy blood has abundantly enriched our souls by thy grace. For while the watering of the river may be plenteous, it can never satisfy our thirst for thee. Thou givest the grain gold, dancing upon the wind. Thy touch upon the ground maketh it pure. How thou fosterest so in thy tenderness of love and desire. Thy righteous brightness her field of rest and comfort, thence to all intrusion. Thy array covereth openly. Thy beauty is any better to be by thy side, forever intertwined by reason and intent. Thou hast betrothed thy maiden, her comeliness, her elegant immense, thy mind likeness of faithfulness, true to thee as thou art to her. Peace and paradise, prosperity of peace. Thy love has brought to all, everlasting, intertwined. All is weaved into thee by thy toil and claret. Has any had to bear such grief as thee? Lord God, with love and affection, we praise thy ways of righteousness. How open thou hast been to us. Thou hast revealed everything unsealed to us by thy testimonies, plain and truthful, with good understanding that we are thine, and thou art our God of glory. We shout, we sing, and we pray, Christ our Lord. Thou hast ascension to distinction. Thy reign in mercy upon thy throne shineth thy light to give us sight. Dispel dark darkness from the keeper of the grave. Thou art the one and only one our souls to save. How hell crieth foul when it thought it had won. The grip loosened, the door sprung open. Flee we did to thee, liberated are we. The abyss calleth us back. May we say, why suffer us at thy wretchedness? We thank thee, Lord, for thy sacrifice, a lamb like no other. For thy death, a new life thou hast brought. For thy resurrection, a new testament written. For thy kingdom, a new home and nation where thou reignest. For thy blood that has freed us and cleansed us, we keep in respect of thee a hallowed moment as we partake this fruit of the vine. How we honor thee in remembrance of thee on the cross, the grave, thy teachings, thy resurrection, and being our Lord and Savior. Thou art our one and true living God. In thy name, O Christ, we pray in thanksgiving. Amen. in Deuteronomy 15:10. Thou shalt surely give him, and thy heart shall not be grieved when thou givest unto him, because for this thing the Lord thy God shall bless thee in all thy works and all that thou puttest thy hand into. I want to take a moment here. I know this is a little bit longer than I planned, but I know there's always a lot of giving, but to keep everything in the contextual meaning of what God wants and permits, I'd like to read just verse 4. Save when there shall be no poor among you, for the Lord shall greatly bless thee in the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee for an inheritance to possess it. I know this giving is separate from the communion, from the bread and wine. I wanted to bring a point. I know there's always a lot of giving, and I know it's a lot of people, when you talk to them, they always say, yeah, the church always wants you to give. Well, yes. God also wants you to be able to prosper also, to save for, you know, your health, your retirement, your education, your kids' education, you know. So there's nothing wrong when you have to put some things aside like that. But what you have to keep in remembrance is, in its contextual meaning, God will always come first, okay? Whatever benefits or something that you accumulate wealth, there should always be a portion for God first. He should always come first. And then everything else set aside for your needs. God gave everything for us, and we should be able to appreciate what he has done for us. Because I know myself, I've been blessed. I mean, I worked, labored the field, you know. That one verse where it says you're going to work the sweat off your eye, your brow. Well, it took my hair off too, you know. So I worked. Thank you for your time. I just wanted to mention that. I hope I conveyed that thought. Our loving Lord, God of all the earth, designer of all living creatures, great in thy insight, external and internal, of all humans, magnificence of thy wonders, plants, animals, water, and fire, all made for our use and our daily needs. We thank thee, Lord, thou hast much kindness towards us. Please accept our gratitude for your love, for we cherish thy generosity of abundance thou hast bestowed upon us. We thank thee, Lord, always for thy Son Christ thou hast sent to us. Having given us a connection to thee in the flesh, it gives us a better understanding that as we see he experienced us on earth, we can say God came to us and he knows us. He knoweth our shortfalls, infirmaries, much so our limitations of what we are able. Thou giveth it very simple for us to understand thy ways and to be thy child. We see thee in thy light. We search the dark no more, nor whisper in the night. A step we take, a hand we see. Do we dare lift our eyes? A gentle voice in our ears. Stay no more in thy cryptic field. I know thee well. Come and know me here. Yea, Lord, by thy light we have our life. Souls to bear thou had done. Never unnoticed were we ever. Thank you, God Almighty, that we can meet in thy name and be enriched in knowledge of thy perfect ways, to be prepared at thy calling. We humbly hearken to thee, for we understandeth what thou hast done for our being. Help us with strength, O Lord. Let us not drift away from thee. Help us always to give thee the praise that is due unto thee and thee alone. Guide us through strife. Restore us in thy love. Hide our failures in thy mercies. Help us always to move closer to thy light. Endlessly in thy grace, in comfort are we in thy cover. As we give this day to thee, God Almighty, we pray it will be accepted of thee. For we know thy blessings and riches cannot be bought and sold. We give in cheerfulness to thee and open of heart. For we know the riches of all the kingdoms cannot and will not buy forgiveness. It is something it is something freely from thee, and that is our richest blessing we could receive from thee. Thank thee, God Almighty, for thy gift in Christ Jesus, in whom all things are given. It is in great love we pray, Christ our Savior. Amen.
All right, ladies and gents, the song after the message will be from page 272, which should be, I have decided to follow Jesus, so you can, in the book, y'all can use a little string, so 272. And then the song before the message and scripture reading will be from page 351. Page 351. So on my end, I'm gonna start off a little bit low so I can go ahead and hit the high part on there. So I'm not a little richer than anybody, so I'm just trying to make sure I bring everybody out. So if we all have it, let us say amen. If we all have it, let's begin. Troublesome times are here, filling men's heart with fear. Freedom we all hold dear, now it's at stake. And humble your hearts to God, safe from the chastening rod. Seek the way pilgrims try, Christians away. And my Jesus is coming soon, morning or night or noon. Many will meet their doom, trumpets will sound. And all of the dead shall rise, righteous meet in the sky, going where no one die, heavenward bound. Troubles will soon be over, happy forevermore. When we meet on that shore, free from all care, rising up in the sky, telling this world goodbye. Onward we then will fly, glory to share. And my Jesus is coming soon, morning or night or noon. Many will meet their doom, trumpets will sound. And all of the dead shall rise, righteous beat in the sky, going where no one die, heavenward bound. And my Jesus is coming soon, morning or
many will meet their doom. Trumpets will surely sound. Heavenly shall rise. Righteous meet in the skies. Going where no one dies. heavenward bound.
Welcome, Eastwood.
Hey.
Awesome sauce. We're going to get to that point. I appreciate you guys all being here. I appreciate all this. Remember, I like that. You guys are made in God's image. All right. So, you know, everybody's here. I appreciate it. If you guys please stand as we turn and read our scripture verses. There you go. And we'll be reading from Matthew, third chapter, verses 3 through 10. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called sons of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven.
Please be seated. You remember the story about the country boy that asked his daddy if a mule was a Christian? Dad looked at him sort of puzzled, says, "Why do you ask that, son?" He said, "Well, he's got such a long, sad face." Today we're talking about happiness. The Christian life is supposed to be happy. We are supposed to be happy. And it's based on a joyous life. It's based on God's love. It's based on the fact and the knowledge that we are aware that God loves us. And the verses that were just read are called the Beatitudes. And the Beatitudes describe Christian happiness. The word that we typically read, blessed, is translated blessing, is actually better understood to mean happy. The beatitude is an interjection. Like someone says, "Oh, blessed of, oh, the happiness of, oh, congratulations." All of this is to explain to us what it feels like when you suddenly have that rush of joy because somehow you have been blessed in your life. And you may say, "Yahoo!" You're happy. It's in you and it's deep. But this is a religious feeling, not an emotion. And that's an area where I think many times people get tripped up because they think God commands emotion. He does not. Emotion comes out as a result of what is within us or what we have done. It's a joyous thrill. In the face of the Beatitudes, of a gloom has encompassed Christianity that's almost unthinkable. But happiness should be at our core because, well, and we're going to be talking about because of what we have with God. The Dalai Lama got it. He said, "Happiness is not something ready-made. It comes from your own actions." And this has to do with our actions and our relationship and our connection with God. Now, the first thing we want to look at, we used to sing a song, "Thank you, Lord, for loving me. Thank you, Lord, for saving me." That's what needs to be in our heart all the time. That thankfulness, that awareness. Well, let's look at the Beatitude. Blessed are the poor in spirit. Wow, somehow that just sounds wrong. I mean, it's not happy to be poor. So we need to understand the passage and how it's written and how it applies to us. It's a paradox. In the Hebrew and the Greek language, there are different words for poor. One is the working class that has no extras in life, and the other is the totally destitute who is oppressed for a lack of affluence. So where does this happiness come from? It comes because one has put their entire trust in God. It is the happiest of all. Financial status doesn't matter. It's our connection to God. So when we say happy are the poor in spirit, we're saying happy are those who are connected to God, whose God is holding their hand, that they have the promise of eternal life. They are indeed the happiest of all, the true penitent. I'm going to ask you at this time, if you would, to raise your hand and say with me, if we could have the yellow slide, please. Say this with me. Raise your hand. I want a hand up. I am happy because I am humble. Amen. Thank you. Put your hands down. Now, the next beatitude says, blessed are those who mourn. Now, again, that's an absurdity. How can you mourn and be happy? It's a contradiction. It doesn't work that way. It's crazy. Well, actually, it's not exactly the opposite of sorrow. We have here again, in the Greek and the Hebrew, the deepest sorrow that you can have. Now, this can be taken different ways. First, we look at 1 Corinthians chapter 7, and we recognize that we're not talking about an earthly happiness. We're not talking about an earthly mourning. We're not talking about, well, we are talking about a spiritual. Blessed are those who mourn about what? Well, about what you have and what others don't have. Now, we know literally, because of where we live, that all sunshine makes a desert. So maybe sometimes it's good to have a little rain come along. Maybe sometimes in life it's good for us to recognize there's an area for regret, and there are things for which we might need to struggle with. But regret is not carrying the constant burden of guilt. Regret is rather saying, I wish I hadn't done that, and I'm not going to do it again. But it's not feeling sad because of something you did last week or last year or last decade. The mourning is because you have been forgiven. You understand forgiveness. And you can have compassion on the world. And that's what drives us in evangelism, to share the good news of Jesus, to tell other people about our Savior, because we know how much it's meant to us. And so I mourn for those who are lost that don't have our joy. So we are happy when we have compassion. It's like a deep concern that you would have as a parent would have for a child. We're not talking about something just casual. We're talking about something that's deep down inside of you. And when you have that concern for the lost, then you have that joy and that happiness. It is a sick personality that is self-centered, that is a bully, and that is cruel. And yet we know those kind of people are out there, but that's not to be the Christian. That's not to be the child of God. Because we are happy because we're compassionate for other people and their struggles that they have with sin and their need to have the Savior in their life. Again, would you raise your hand and say with me, we can get the next slide, please. Together, I am happy because I care. You care for Jesus Christ and you care for those that he came and died for. You care for those who haven't come to him yet. You care for those who need Jesus. That is happiness. The next Beatitudes is blessed are the meek. We use the word meek as someone who's like Mr. Milquetoast, who doesn't have a spine, who's weak and everybody pushes him around. You know, even his three-year-old kid pushes him around. No, we've misunderstood what the word means here in this context. Don't confuse it with our English word, but rather it is to be submissive to God. Gentle in spirit, but submissive to God. Not vehement or angry or violent or bitter or rebellious or mean-spirited, but one who is strong but yet has control. Think of some of the biblical characters that you know that were strong and yet were in control. Think about David. Think about Samson. Think about Moses. Think about Jesus Christ. Strong, powerful, but yet were in control and put themselves under God's will. That's what it means when it says meek, to be submissive to God, to do God's will. So yes, man, we are to be meek, but we're not to be sissies. We're not to be wimps. We're to stand strong for God. You know, David was strong when he was a little boy. Remember that? Probably a preteen, maybe a teenager, but he goes out against Goliath. You just imagine a 12 or 13-year-old kid going up against a 7-foot man who's dressed in armor, carrying a shield, a spear, and a sword. That's not the kind of fight I'd want to be in. But even later, as an adult, he was still as brave and as strong and submissive to God. If you want to think of yourself as a godly man, think of yourself as a weak man. No, think of yourself as a meek man who is strong. Righteousness, indignation, godly anger. We're not to be selfish. The word is also used in connection to an animal that's been domesticated and trained and in control. Have you ever been around a team of horses or mules or oxen and you know that they've been trained to do their job? Or maybe you've seen some of the dogs that have been trained by the military and the police and other people and how excellent they are. And yet when you look at them, you know, this is a pretty fierce dog. It weighs 100, 150 pounds. It can take a person down in a heartbeat. And yet, it just sits there almost smiling because it knows what to do because it has submitted to its master. That's what we're to be. This is not a vain person, not a lofty-minded or arrogant person, either before man or before God. We've seen them in Moses. We've seen them in Jesus. We know about the yoke that is put on the oxen. All of these are examples of how we can be strong and yet submissive. It says they will inherit the earth. Well, since all the others have been taken spiritually, we need to do this and understand as well that he's not talking here about the physical earth now or later. This is not a premillennial thing about Jesus is going to come back and give you the world. No, that's not what it's about. It's about you inheriting the real world. That's God's world. That's the spiritual world. The promised land that we call heaven. Once again, would you raise your hand and say together, I am happy because I submit. That's what we need to do. And we will be happy when we submit to God's will. Blessed are those, the next beatitude, who hunger and thirst for righteousness. Well, again, I don't know about you, but for most people, hunger and thirst is pretty powerful. We have a lot of drives within us. But when you get hungry, you get hungry. And when you get thirsty, you're thirsty. And you'll be saying things like, I got to have something to eat. I got to have something to drink. I mean, it's important to you. You want to do it right now. It's very deep in our souls and in our minds, our bodies. Well, we need to have that drive for righteousness. We need to have that drive for godliness. We need to have that drive to be the kind of person Jesus was. We need to hunger and thirst to do good. We have also a drive for forgiveness. We have a drive where we need to forgive others. Perhaps you've seen pictures of other countries that used to be quite popular to be showing photographs of grocery stores in Russia and other communist countries where the shelves were empty. You could go to the store, but it wouldn't do you any good. There was no food on the shelf. People were hungry, but it didn't matter. There wasn't any food to be found. Water doesn't come from the faucet. I'm not sure this story is true. I heard it decades ago about some rich Arab sheikh came to visit America, and he stayed in a fancy hotel, and he turned the water on, and it came out of that faucet. And the story is that when he cleared out, when he went home, he'd taken all the faucets back with him. But we know the water doesn't come from the faucet, does it? It comes from somewhere else. But when you have that drive, all you think of is feeding yourself and feeding others. You think of forgiveness. How intense, personal now, how intense is your drive for goodness? Total, complete goodness. How much do you want to be good? Well, if you hunger and thirst for righteousness, you shall be filled. You shall be filled with God's love and God's forgiveness, and you will be pure and white as snow. You do right here, and you will enjoy the hereafter. Once again, raise your hand and say these words with me. I am happy because I crave godliness. And you crave that godliness. Not just now when we come here and we all, you know, look at one another. We look halfway decent, kind of combed our hair. And okay, yeah, you're a nice guy. No. Tomorrow, when you're out there in that dirty world and temptation is coming at you, crave godliness. And I mean crave it like you were starving to death for one drop of water. All you need is one cup of water. All you need is one opportunity to be righteous, to be good, to do good to someone else. The next beatitude reads, blessed are the merciful. Now, the merciful seek to do the best for their fellows. They extend forgiveness willingly. As God forgives us, we can forgive others. James chapter 2. And the whole point is that we become, in a sense, God incarnate. Don't get me wrong. Don't take it too far. But God is acting in us, and we are able to forgive others because He has forgiven us. Forgive people. I'd hate to see the list of names of people who have hurt you and who have sinned against you. But let's forget them. Let's don't even make a list. Let's just forgive them. Let's try to put it out of our mind. James chapter 2 and Matthew chapter 6, verse 12. Forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. In other words, there's two sides to this thing. It's reciprocal. We have to forgive and develop a heart of forgiveness if we expect to have the forgiveness of God. This is not one of those things, oh, I prayed or I was baptized or whatever. No, you have to live it. It has to become a part of who you are. And you need to forgive from the heart. Forgiveness comes in two stages. First, there's the willingness to forgive, as was manifested by Jesus in Luke chapter 23, and later by Stephen. You remember the disciple, the Christian Stephen in Acts chapter 7, who was literally being stoned to death? And you remember Jesus on the cross said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And now here's Stephen being stoned. He says, Father, forgive them. Boy, that's quick forgiveness, isn't it? That's quick forgiveness. That's forgiveness while the pain is going on, while the destruction is going on. Not tomorrow when you had a chance to get well and think about it. Right now, while it's happening. That's strong. The natural urge is to seek revenge. But the Lord says, vengeance is mine. So let's forgive and let God take care of the justice. Evil ones, they must repent to be forgiven. Jesus prayed for those people who were killing him, and not just the soldiers, but the crowd who were cheering it on, that they be forgiven. But they weren't forgiven just because Jesus prayed it. They weren't forgiven until they turned. And when you forgive someone, that doesn't mean God's forgiven them. They still have to respond to God. That's their responsibility. Our responsibility is to forgive, because forgiveness, mercy, is active. We might even say it's proactive. We don't wait until someone comes and begs us for forgiveness. Forgive them now. Remember John the Immerser, Luke chapter 3 and verse 8, says we are to produce fruit in keeping with repentance. And Jesus said in Luke 13:3, unless you repent. So we have to be involved in this mercy part. But don't think you're giving them a free walk. No, they're still going to answer to God. This repentance is for us. See, we often don't understand that forgiveness is for us. For our hearts to be unburdened, to our hearts to be lifted, because we have forgiven someone who has done us a big wrong, but we're not going to let that destroy our lives and who and what we are. If they ask us for forgiveness without repenting and do the same sin again, we're not obligated to let those people back into our lives, nor are those who are intent on destroying us. We are to be willing to forgive, praying that they will change. But it doesn't require you to be a doormat. Understand that. Mercy is activated, but not passive. You remember the story of the Good Samaritan? The guy's walking down the side of the road. The first two were people who were looked up to, and they were the holiest of holies, the priest and the Levite. Oh, the good guys. And they saw this man injured almost to the point of death. And what did they do? They walked on the other side of the road so maybe they could pretend they didn't see it. Have you ever done that? You know, oh, look over there. You know, look to the left because there's something on the right I don't want to see. I don't know what their motive was. Or they were just trying to excuse themselves. But what did the Samaritan do? Now, again, you have to remember who the Samaritan was. Samaritan was a man or a person that they held in contempt. To them, all Samaritans were dogs. Talk about prejudice. They did not like him at all. And yet, who came and helped the man who was bleeding and almost dying? He saw a need and he acted. Blessed are the merciful. Jesus caught a woman in adultery. Or she was brought to him. He didn't catch her. And he said, sin no more. He didn't mock her. He didn't make fun of her. He didn't condemn her. He just said, sin no more. Merciful is being godlike. It's being an intelligent mercy. I read a story of a man who found a cocoon. And the emperor moth that was inside was beginning to break out. And he just was interested, curious, and he decided to watch it. So he watched this moth as it began to try to break out of the cocoon and in its struggle. And didn't seem to be making any progress. There, one little hole appeared, but then nothing happened. It just slowed. And he could see this moth inside struggling. He could see the movement underneath the cocoon. He knew this was trying to get out. Well, this man felt merciful. And he got some little scissors, and he snipped the cocoon so the moth could get out. And he expected the moth to develop wings and fly, but instead it came out, its body was large and was swollen. The wings were small and they were swiveled. He expected the moth to be able to fly, but instead it struggled. And it would never fly. You see, interestingly enough, the moth needed the struggle of getting out of the cocoon in order to force the fluid from its body into its wings. And that little snip the merciful man did was actually a cruelty, because he took away the struggle. I know that sometimes in life we would like to have no struggles. But today you are the person you are because of the struggles that you have gone through. You have the strength of faith and the courage to meet the challenges of the world because of the struggles that you've gone through. And no doubt there will be additional struggles in your life. Don't be angry about them. Don't hate God and everybody else. I would ask you again to raise your hand and say these words with me. I am happy because I am forgiven. You see, when I am forgiven, I can be merciful to others. When I realize I'm forgiven, and I think some of us aren't really convinced of that. It really hasn't sunk in. It's like, I don't know what it's like. It's like we know something, but we don't really believe it. It's like a warranty on a car or a refrigerator. You got a warranty, but you've never used it, so you don't think you need it or don't have it. We don't really appreciate the warranty and what it is. We have a warranty with God, and that warranty is He's forgiven us and needs to make us different toward other people. The next beatitude is, blessed are the poor in heart. We're talking here about motives and thinking of not being hypocritical in life, not being hypocritical as a person, being someone who's real and genuine. Hear me, ritual does not interest Jesus. Now, we like ritual because it means we've done something. We can see it. We're aware. Yeah, I did this today. Or I did. No, no. From inside you. The Beatitudes, the things we've been talking about, those come from inside you. So, what is there inside you? There's a story told about an old preacher of decades ago, centuries ago perhaps, of John Bunyan. And it says that he was leaving the worship assembly, and someone came to him and said, "You preached well." And he said, "I know. The devil told me as I was coming down the streets, the steps of the pulpit." You see, the man knew his skill. He knew he'd done a good sermon. You see, what we're talking about here is our humanity. What you have within you, it's sometimes you've done something and it's hard to be humble. Didn't somebody write a song about that? Can't remember. But yeah, that's what we strive for, to be pure in heart. You want to know the most beautiful woman in the world? It's the woman who doesn't know it and doesn't act like it. Same thing applies to the most handsome man. Don't you hate the prima donnas? Yeah. Pure in heart. Joyful to realize we're true to God. We struggle with our humanity. We all do, and we all will. But we need to be pure to God. Not only will we see Him, others will see Him in us. That's the blessing. Once again, would you raise your hand and say together with me, "I am happy because I am genuine." Be true. Be genuine. Be real. The next beatitude is, blessed are the peacemakers. Peacemakers bring others together. Peacemakers don't drive people off. They bring them together. Shalom, the Hebrew word for peace, is not just the absence of trouble. It's the enjoyment of all good. Enjoy what you have. You got two scoops of ice cream at the ice cream shop. You get bumped and the top one falls off. Well, I know you're going to miss that, but you know what? You still got one left. Enjoy what you have in life. Sometimes life bumps into you and knocks off that extra scoop of ice cream. Enjoy what you have. Of all the good that's in your life, there are people in your life that you would like for them to be better, but maybe they can't. Enjoy the goodness that's in them, that's there. Peacemaker helps others to solve their problems. We sometimes joke about in-laws being troublemakers because sometimes that's true. Intentional or not, whether they realize it or not, it may be true. They don't have to be. And we don't have to make them troublemakers. And sometimes we do that ourselves. We make them troublemakers, but the way we act toward them, we're supposed to be peacemakers. It's easy to live with a peacemaker, whether it's a spouse or an in-law or a parent or a child. But you know, you can't be at peace with others if you're not at peace with yourself. And being at peace with yourself has to do with your relationship with God. You cannot take your troubles with you. You know, we all probably have a wallet or a pocketbook. And if you need something, yeah, it's right here, and we reach for our pocketbook. But don't carry your troubles with you. Shake them off. Get rid of them. If you're a troublemaker, then just repent. Stop it. You know, nobody else wants you to be a troublemaker. Nobody's asked you to be a troublemaker. Most of the people who know you and love you and are closest to you don't want you to be a troublemaker. It probably breaks their heart. Don't be a troublemaker. Once again, would you raise your hand and say with me, "I am happy because I am at peace." Amen. You know, you be at peace with yourself and at peace with God. You don't have to be a troublemaker. The last beatitude is, blessed are those who are persecuted. Now that doesn't sound like much fun, does it? How can I be happy if I'm being persecuted? Well, it's because you're being persecuted for a cause worth dying for. For one that you're willing to give your life in service. It's a worthwhile cause. It's not just the fly-by-night crazy idea we got. But we've committed ourselves. In the movie Saving Private Ryan, the character Captain Miller, played by Tom Hanks, in the end, I missed a couple of things I wanted to say. Yeah, I did. I'm sorry. Let me talk about this. Well, wherever I am, I'll pick up with a slideshow now. The Private Ryan character at the end of the movie visits the grave of the Tom Hanks character. And his wife comes up and he asks her, basically tells her, tell me I've led a good life. And the reason is because he knows how many men died to get to him and send him home. I don't remember the count on the scene in the movie once. He knows. And the question for me, and the question for you, who died for you? So I wasn't in the war, you know, I wasn't, no. Who died on the cross for you and your sins? Jesus Christ did. And so because of that, we have a cause worth dying for. We have a cause worth living for. We have a reason to go out tomorrow and face the world because Jesus died for us and Jesus is on our side. You want to know something? Jesus was happy on the cross. Wow. You ever think of it that way? He knew he was doing the right thing. Once again, would you raise your hand and say with me, I am happy because I pay the price. So live your life. Pay the price. You are a Christian. You are a child of God. Walk the pathway. Now, Christian happiness is not laughing over a joke. It's knowing that you're living life to the greatest cause and the greatest purpose ever known to mankind. Life is hard. It can be difficult. The Christian life can be even harder. But we serve in the name of Jesus Christ, our living God and Savior. We dedicate our lives to His kingdom and rejoice that we have the honor to serve in His cause. We get to be in the Christian army. Therefore, even in difficult times, the most difficult times of life, we find joy in Jesus, knowing we are destined to hear, well done, good and faithful servant. So this time I'm going to ask you to stand. Would you stand, please, and say these words with me? Happiness is living for Jesus. Let us sing.
I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back, no turning back. Though none go with me, I still will follow. Though none go with me, I still gon' follow. Though none go with me, I still will follow. No turning back, no turning back. My cross I carry till I see Jesus. My cross I carry till I see Jesus. My cross I carry till I see Jesus.
Please be seated. Let's join together in prayer. Loving Father in heaven, we are grateful for the many blessings that you have given us this day. We're most mindful, Father, that we have the blessing of coming to you through your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, that we can thank you for the blessings that you give us. And Father, help us to truly understand all the blessings we have, especially those blessings that we have being in your family and being called your children. Father, help us not to take those for granted, but to use those blessings in a way that would bring glory to you and that would honor you, Father. Father, in doing that, we need your help. We need you to guide us and direct us. We need you to help us see that guidance and direction. And we need your strength and for the courage that we need to be your children in this world. Father, help us reflect your light to the world around us. Help us to be the people that we need to be. Father, we're always asking, but Father, you know we are weak in many ways, that we stumble and sin. And we pray that you will help us to look to you and reach out to you for the grace and the mercy that you give. Help us to learn the lessons that your Son Jesus brought to us, that we may learn to live a life that is happy and productive in your service. And Father, thank you that you have heard us and that you grant us these things because you love us. Father, we ask so many things, but we ask that you would help us appreciate the nation that we live in, appreciate this world that we live in, and help us to be the people that will use your blessings, use those wonderful things that you have given us and made for us in a way that's productive in your sight, Father. Please help those that are hurting this morning, those that are sick physically, those who are sick in spirit, Father, that you would grant healing, that you would make it your will to give them comfort and strength. Father, again, we ask your guidance and your direction through life, that we may truly learn to be your family and your children, and share you with those around us. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
All right, guys, I'm going to give this one a shot. So this is one of the ones I did when I was a kid. I'm going to do one verse of it. All right, we all got it. Let's begin. Time is filled with transition, and all on earth the mood shall stand. Build your hopes on things eternal, and hold
to God's unchanging hand. Why don't you hold to God's unchanging hand and hold to God's unchanging hand and build your hopes on things eternal and hold to God's unchanging hand. That's it.